Praise the Lord. His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins they are many, His mercy is more. I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I met you. I was breathing. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn, yeah, till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the dark.
Testing 1 2, testing 1 2, check, check, testing 1 2, testing 1 2 3 4, testing 1 2.
Cause when you call my name, shout it, I 2017. Let's hear it. The loudest shout you've got in you. Give it to us.
Hey, good afternoon, and welcome to FBC Live, the first of many live Bible teaching and Bible study times we're going to have live here from the Worship Center at FBC, and we're glad to have you here with us. If you want to begin getting ready as I do some sort of introductory kinds of things, you can be turning your Bibles to Genesis chapter 34. We're going to be picking up where I left off in our FBC Wednesday night studies. We've been working through the book of Genesis, so we're picking up where we left off in Genesis 34. So this afternoon, from now until probably 12:30 or 12:45, we're going to be working our way through those three chapters, and you're going to find it most beneficial if you have your Bible out and are able to follow along through the text as we study and consider what's going on in Genesis 34, 35, and 36. A couple of quick things to make you aware of so you can get the most out of this teaching time. First of all, have your Bible open and be interacting. If you like to take notes, take notes. If you prefer to just sit and listen, then just sit and listen. But also, I'm really used to these particular Bible studies being really interactive. Usually when I'm teaching this, I've got a group of people in front of me, and people are interrupting and raising their hands and offering questions and comments. And we want to do the same thing to the degree we're able to in this live streaming environment. So at the bottom of the screen, you'll see my email, gspires@fbcmedford.org.
And I've got my laptop right here. And so what I'm going to be doing is from time to time, not all the time, from time to time, I'll check my email to see if there's any questions or comments that we might be able to utilize to create a little bit of a discussion going on. Questions you might have that I'm not touching on, or maybe you have an observation that would be helpful for all of us. So don't hesitate to send me an email. And throughout our time together, I'll be looking over and checking my email and seeing if we have any interaction. And of course, on the live stream, if you've logged in as a live stream with your live stream identity, you're welcome to chat with one another. But today we don't have a moderator on the live stream chat. So if you want to interact with me, you're going to need to send me an email. Just a couple of quick announcements here. Coming up this week, you'll be getting a postcard like this if we have your address. If we don't have your address, you'll have to call us and give us your address. And this postcard will have our program schedule on it throughout the week, the resources that we want to provide to you so that you continue to grow in your knowledge of the Lord through His Word and through prayer. We have coming up this week, of course, today and tomorrow at noon, our Bible teaching time. These Bible teaching times are replayed in the evening at 7 p.m. So at 7 p.m., the video of this time will be replayed. It won't be live, but it will be on the live stream channel. And then, of course, on Sunday mornings, we have students getting together at 9 o'clock through Zoom and Facebook. And we have our 10:30 a.m. worship services, as well as our Kids Zone this coming Sunday, which is on demand for parents. And the reason we're offering all of these resources is while we are pausing as a community to make sure that we stop the spread of the coronavirus, we don't want to hit pause on our spiritual growth in the Lord. And we think coming together in these ways, as strange as it may seem, are important in challenging one another in our growth in the Lord. So be sure to take advantage of the resources that we're providing to you to continue to grow in the Lord together. So hopefully you've got your Bible open to Genesis 34, and we're going to begin in chapter 34, work our way through the passage, and then we'll have some ways in which this is going to be important for each of us in our life. But let me begin, before we jump into the Word, with a word of prayer. God, we thank you for this time. We thank you for the time that we can gather as a group of individuals to study your Word. We're asking, God, that your Holy Spirit would do a work in our hearts, that you would show us what your word means, show us ways in which we need to trust you more, show us the places in our life we need to repent. And God, would you give us open eyes, open hearts, and open minds to how we might grow in you based on who you are, especially as how you make yourself known to us through your word this afternoon. So we ask your grace in this moment that this would be time of fruitful Bible study together. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, chapters 34, 35, and 36 of the book of Genesis. We're going to focus most of our attention for the time we're together on chapter 34. That's really the meat and potatoes of our study. We're going to take a few minutes to cover chapter 35. And chapter 36, honestly, we're going to mention that it exists, and then that's about it. Where are we in Genesis? Genesis is the story of the seed that God is going to bring redemption for all of humankind. Genesis began with creation, and right away we disobeyed God in the Garden of Eden. And God made a promise in Genesis chapter 3 that the seed would come. That seed would have his heel bruised, but he would strike the head of the enemy. And really what we've been talking about, especially on FBC Wednesday nights, is the story of Genesis is God tracing the line of that seed, which will find its culmination in Jesus Christ, the seed who will bring blessing to all of humankind. So really the story of Genesis is following that covenant promise of God to bring redemption through his seed, that is, salvation through people, which was culminated in Christ when God came as a man. So while we're going to look at chapters 34 and 35, and there are some elements of the narrative here in chapters 34 and 35 that are very disturbing, very uncomfortable and difficult to read, we want to fully grapple with the realities of the situation that is described, But at the same time, we want to fit that reality into the overarching narrative arc, which is God is going to bring redemption through his seed. So let's begin with chapter 34. Now, I'm going to read parts of this, and you're going to need to follow along if you would like in your copy of the scripture, because the text will not be up on the video screen for you. Here's what it says in Genesis 34, beginning in verse 1. Now, Dinah, the daughter of Leah, whom she had born to Jacob, went out to see the women of the land. Okay, we're going to stop there because we need to make sure we understand where we are in the story. Dinah is Jacob's daughter, and Dinah is the daughter of Jacob and his wife Leah. Now, remember, Jacob had two wives and two concubines, and his favored wife was Rachel, and Leah, though, was the wife who had most of his children, including his daughter, Dinah. And it's making the point here to help us pay attention that Dinah was the daughter of Leah because the sons who were involved in the story later we need to pay attention to because they are also daughters, or sons, I should say, of Leah. And we're going to see why that's important. The sons who are involved in the story later on are full-blooded siblings with Dinah. And what has happened up to this point is Jacob had journeyed and had lived with his father-in-law Laban, and his father-in-law, and he had difficult times, and Jacob became very wealthy, and finally he and his whole family fled. And just previously in the book of Genesis, he had come to peaceful terms with Esau, and now he is sort of settling in the land, getting nice and comfortable and established. And Dinah has now gone out, and she's going to interact with the women of the land. And that, let's continue on with what it says here in verses 2, 3, and 4. And when Shechem, the son of Hamor the Hivite, the prince of the land, saw her, he seized her, and he lay with her and humiliated her. And his soul was drawn to Dinah, the daughter of Jacob. He loved the young woman, and he spoke tenderly to her. So Shechem spoke to his father Hamor and said, "Get me this girl for my wife." So right away, the chapter starts off with the disturbing scene of Dinah being assaulted by Shechem. There's broad debate on what actually occurred. Was this something she consented to, but they were unmarried, so it shamed her, or did he force himself upon her? And honestly, it's quite clear, it seems to me, that this was an assault. But at the end of the day, the point is, the story makes clear that Dinah had been shamed, that she had received shame from Shechem. And in an honor-shame culture, that is so critically important that whatever happened, whether she said consented to the sexual interaction or whether she didn't consent to it, she received shame from it. Because in this culture, she was powerless. She would have had no way to defend herself against this powerful leader in his city. And he humiliated her, it says. She has received on herself shame that would be borne by her family, and the culture would look down on her, not even to mention, the nature of the assault itself. And so this is a disturbing way for this to start. And so it creates this great tension in us. What's going to happen? Because even the last verse is disturbing. He goes to his father and he says, "Get me this girl for my wife." Not only did he assault her, he wants to have her for his wife, which of course would mean negotiating and figuring that out with her father, who is Jacob. So it creates this tension in us. Well, what's going to happen? Where is this going to go? How is this going to get resolved? Jacob has just gotten settled in the land, and now this significant and heinous crime has occurred. What is he going to do? How is he going to respond? And the Bible tells us how he responds. Jacob heard what happened to his daughter. His sons were out with his livestock, and they were tending in the field. And it says Jacob kept his peace until his sons came home. This is verse 5 of chapter 34. It feels like, as we're reading this, that Jacob takes this very passive and docile approach. His daughter has been assaulted by this man. Why isn't he getting upset? Why isn't he at least verbally accosting Shechem and his father Hamor? Why is he even allowing them to come into his area where his tents are set up. But instead, he just sort of keeps his peace. He keeps his calm until his sons come home. And he appears passive. And why is this so frustrating? Because something has happened here, and what we want to have happen as we're reading this, what you and I want to have happen as we're reading this story, is we want justice to be done. Something bad has happened. Shame and humiliation has occurred, not only, not to mention violence and fear, and we want justice to be done. And so the first person that should be the one primarily in charge of bringing justice for Dinah is Jacob, and his response, it says, is to keep his peace. And when we read that, we should get very frustrated. Is it, what are you doing? You should be bringing justice, but instead you're going to chill. That doesn't sit right with most of us, and it shouldn't sit right with us, and I think that's what the story is trying to bring out in us, is trying to show us we all want justice done, and we want it done properly, and we want people to have their shame removed. And we want, when somebody experiences wrong, for it to be made right. And when we read about these kinds of stories in the news, or when we hear from them about them in our personal life, our reaction is anger and frustration, and justice should be done. And in fact, that's the image of God coming out in us, saying, when something wrong happens, justice should be done. And Jacob takes this very passive approach, which for most of us is very frustrating and difficult to deal with. Then look what happens in verse 7. So we get the other side of the fence. If Jacob is sitting with his hands folded and just saying, okay, I understand what's going on, his sons are sort of on the other end of the spectrum. Look what it says in verse 7 of chapter 34. The sons of Jacob had come in from the field, and as soon as they heard of it, the men were indignant and very angry. So here we have these two spectrums. Jacob hears about it and he keeps his peace. And we're going to find out why in a minute. And the sons come in from the field, and they hear about it, and they fly into a rage. And it tells us exactly why they fly into a rage. Because Shechem had done an outrageous thing in Israel by lying with Jacob's daughter, a thing that should not have been done. They recognize this should not have happened. Dinah now bears shame she should not bear. The family bears shame it should not have to bear. And they are angry because justice should be done. Jacob appears passive, and the sons appear angry. And we have a role in seeing justice done, and we're going to see how both of these parties in this situation are going to approach this in the incorrect way. Jacob is not going to do anything actively to remove shame. The brothers are going to do so, but in a way that it should not be done. But they have a role as covenant keepers of God, as covenant bearers of God, to act the way God would when injustice occurs. And we have two failures. One is passivity, and the other one is revenge. These are people who bear the covenant promises of God, and they should be seeking justice rightly done. And instead, one party is going to be overly passive, and the other parties, instead of just seeking justice, they are going to seek revenge, which is not the same as justice. So Shechem and his father Hamor, they come to Jacob and his sons, and they want to strike a deal. We're going to discover later in the story, we're wondering maybe, well, where is Dinah? Where's the daughter? She's still at Shechem's house. The narrative doesn't make clear whether or not she was there voluntarily or whether or not she was being held there against her will. But the fact is, what choice would she have in the matter? With somebody like Shechem, a powerful and honored figure in his city, if she wanted to leave, do we really think that she could leave safely? Do we think she really had a say in the matter? And so she's still at home, and they're going to come together for a negotiation. What Shechem and Hamor want, Shechem and Hamor want a deal to be struck where Shechem can marry Jacob's daughter. And of course, what Jacob and his sons are going to be seeking is justice. Both parties are trying to gain the advantage over the other one. Shechem and Hamor are coming, and their primary negotiation tool is the fact that they still have Dinah in custody, and they are the established members of this community. Jacob, on his side, what he has going for him is he is very wealthy. He is very powerful. He has shown himself as such so far in the book of Genesis. And Shechem and Hamor see an opportunity for advantage for their city by striking a deal with Jacob and his sons. And so they strike a deal. And this is sort of an interesting deal, and so it's worth reading. We're in verse 8, and this deal sort of takes place between verses 8 and verse 17 of Genesis 34. Hamor, Shechem's father, spoke and said, "Listen, my son really longs for your daughter. Please give him your daughter as a wife." And then he continues, let's not just have this one marriage. Let's have many marriages between your people and our people. We'll give you our daughters. You give us your daughters. We'll dwell together in the land, and we will trade together, and we're going to gain property together. Really, this is his pitch. Let's make a peace treaty together, sealed by marriage, and we're both going to get rich off this deal. We can trade together, and we can dominate the land, and they want to make this deal. Shechem, in verse 11, says this, if you want to look. Shechem also said, "Let me find favor in your eyes. Whatever you say to me, I will give." So here we have two people negotiating. We have Hamor the father, the seasoned, grizzled king and leader of the city who's had these kinds of negotiations probably countless times. And now you've got Shechem. He's a little wet behind the ears. He's never maybe been allowed in these sort of negotiations. And not only that, he is motivated by the fact that he wants Dinah as his wife. So while the father Hamor is working to strike a deal that is to his advantage, the young wet behind the ears Shechem pops off with, "Let us know what you want and we'll give it to you." Not a great negotiating tactic for him to basically concede, "You guys have the strength in this bargaining position." Verse 12, "Ask for me the bride price and I'll give it to you. Whatever you want, I will give it to you." He probably shouldn't have done that knowing what's about to occur. So the sons of Jacob had come to this negotiation with a bit of a plan in mind. And they came to him, and it says in verse 13 their perspective. It says, "Jacob answered Shechem and his father deceitfully." Meaning he's going to negotiate with him, but he has no intention of really negotiating with him. They have a plan going on behind the scenes. And here's the plan. The plan is to convince the city that they all need to get circumcised, that all the men need to get circumcised. And here's their pitch, essentially. Listen, we are people who are circumcised, and you can't marry our sister unless you're circumcised. The only way we can strike the kind of deal that you're offering is if all of the men of your city were circumcised. Then we would be into a place where we could have a relationship, where we could exchange one another's daughters in marriage, and we could have a community together and all these kinds of things. Now, what's the problem with that? That's not God's intention. That's not God's plan as he's working through the book of Genesis. The book of Genesis is the story of the seed. And that covenant was affirmed to Abraham, who God said, "I will bless the world through you and your offspring." That covenant was reaffirmed to Isaac, the son of Abraham. And that covenant has been affirmed to Jacob and will be affirmed to Jacob again later in this section. This covenant wasn't given to Shechem and Hamor. And Jacob did not have discretion to extend the covenant to Shechem and Hamor by intermarrying with them. And so they were moving deceitfully. They knew they couldn't bind God's promises through circumcision of the people of this city. They are acting deceitfully because their plan is to invade their city. And so they say, "Listen, what you have to do is you're uncircumcised, and you and all of your men of your city will need to get circumcised in order to for this agreement to be reached. And if you will agree to this, well, then we have ourselves a deal. We'll be able to give you our daughters, and we'll take your daughters in exchange. But if you will not listen to us, then give us our daughter back, and we'll be on our way." So that's the deal they're going to make. They'll be able to intermarry as long as the men of this city will get circumcised. And then the most shocking verse maybe in the book of Genesis, Genesis chapter 34, verse 18, their words pleased Hamor and Hamor's sons. Now, I don't know about you, but that deal wouldn't please me. But apparently this deal sounded really good to them. this should illuminate to us how wealthy Jacob was. He was so wealthy that the profit that they anticipated they would gain from this was worth going through this ordeal. They knew this trade deal would be very profitable for them, and so they were pleased with this arrangement. Look at verse 19 of chapter 34. The young man, that is Shechem, did not delay to do the thing. So Shechem wasn't waiting. He's getting the job done, and the job's getting done right now because he delighted in Jacob's daughter. So Shechem moved quickly, had his procedure done. I'm trying to be polite here. And then they go to the city leaders, and they now have to convince the rest of the men of their city to get circumcised. Now, that seems like a sales pitch that would be hard to pull off, but they are going to go at it by appealing to the greed of the men of the city. They're going to say to them, listen, if we make this deal with Jacob, it's just a matter of time. Everything he owns will be ours because we're going to trade with him, but we have the advantage in this situation, and soon all of his cattle, all of his donkeys, all of his family, all of his resources will be owned by us. So it's profitable for us to go through with this, even though it's painful in the short term. And on this condition, we can have peace with Jacob and his people. And as it turns out, all of the people of the city immediately took action. All of the men of the city said, let's do this. We've got a profitable opportunity here, so let's take full advantage of this. And it's just a procedure. A week or two will go by, and it'll be like it never happened. And so it says in verse 24, all of the men were circumcised, all who went out of the city gate. So the deal was struck, and then the men of the city followed through on their deal, and they all got circumcised. So what was the deceitful plan of Israel and his sons? On the third day, when they're still recovering, and in fact, it seems to indicate this would be the most difficult day of the recovery, on the third day, they were still sore. Two of the sons of Jacob, Simeon and Levi, went into the city with their swords. Now pay attention, who is Simeon and Levi's mother? Simeon and Levi, their mother is Leah. They are full-blooded brothers of their sister Dinah. They want to save their sister. They want to rescue her, and they want to bring justice to the situation. And so they go into the city with their swords. Now we might imagine before we read on, and you're probably familiar with the story, but what would justice look like in this situation? If we were to see justice done, what would justice look like? Well, justice would be done against the one who would cause the shame, and that would be against Shechem, and maybe his father Hamor for his participation in it. But look what happens in verse 25. Dinah's brother took their swords, they came against the city while it felt secure, and they killed every man in the city. They killed Hamor, they killed Shechem, and they took Dinah out of Shechem's house, and they went away. The sons of Jacob plundered the city. They killed every man in the city. They took all of the women and children. They took all of the animals. They took all of the wealth. They completely devastated the city. And so Shechem was destroyed in order to rescue Dinah and to bring some sense of justice. But is it really just for an entire city to be wiped out over one misdeed or a misdeed by one of its members? Look at verse 30 and 31, and suddenly we come to that place where we realize what all the issues are. Jacob said this to his son Simeon and Levi, you've brought trouble on me. You've made me a stink to the inhabitants of the land. The Canaanites and the Perizzites, my numbers are few. If they gather themselves against me and attack me, I will be destroyed, both I and my household. So all of a sudden we see what's going on in Jacob's heart. This evil had been done against his daughter, but what was his primary concern? His primary concern was his personal safety and security. He was afraid to be more active in seeking justice for his daughter because he knew if he poked the beehive with a stick, he could get stung. And so his plan was, let's just play it cool, guys. Let's just chill out a little bit and get established. And the fact is, that is not just. That is not justice. That doesn't properly understand the shame and humiliation of his daughter. The heart of Jacob was more concerned about his own personal well-being than dealing with the shame and humiliation of his daughter. The one person who should have been most concerned about dealing with her shame and humiliation was the least concerned. And that's a terrible bit of brokenness that we see here. But then we also see other bit of brokenness here. He says, listen, you've made me a stink to the inhabitants of the land. In verse 31, here's how the brothers respond. They said this, should he have treated our sister like a prostitute? Should he have treated her with such disdain? And all of a sudden, their hearts are revealed. Yes, they want justice for their sister. And yes, they want her shame and humiliation to be properly accounted for. But more is going on here. You don't wipe out an entire city just because you feel bad for your sister's situation. You wipe out an entire city because you're worried about your own reputation. They're worried about their reputation as those who would sit idly by. They wanted to make a point, not that Dinah's reputation would be restored, but even that their own reputation would be restored. So while Jacob was passive and seemed indifferent to her shame and humiliation, the brothers are engaging with injustice to one degree to help their sister, but to another degree primarily concerned about their own reputations. Dinah did not have a good rescuer. She didn't have someone in that moment who would bring both justice and grace to the moment, because the sons were concerned about their reputation, and Jacob was concerned primarily about his own personal safety and security. Now, when we get to the end of chapter 35, we're going to work through some implications, but we want to touch on this here while it's fresh in our mind. What this does, and what we see repeatedly throughout the Old Testament, is we see a situation like this, and our response should be this. Boy, wouldn't it have been great if Dinah had a rescuer who was concerned about her shame and humiliation? Wouldn't it be great if she had a rescuer who could deal with her shame and humiliation and wasn't concerned about his own personal safety? Somebody who could deal with her shame and humiliation, but wouldn't be angry and vengeful. And what this does is just give us a peek into what's coming in the line of the seed. We need a rescuer who will deal with our shame and humiliation, and who is not concerned about his own personal well-being. Does anybody ring a bell in that count? That sounds a lot like Jesus, doesn't it? Who deals with our shame and humiliation and puts his own life on the line. On the other hand, he is not one who is vengeful and rage-filled and impetuous. When he stands before Pilate, the powerful king of the universe, Jesus is restrained and answers Pilate calmly, "The authority you have has been given you." So everything Jacob was, Jesus is not. Everything her brothers were, Jesus is not. Jesus deals fully with our shame and humiliation, even when it caused his own destruction. And Jesus does so without a vengeful spirit. He does it with love and grace. Why can he do that? Because he's God and the grave can't hold him. And he is raised so we have hope that lasts forever. And so we see in here, the seed is coming, and while Jacob and his sons are the sons of the covenant, they aren't the final seed that we need, which is the Messiah. All right, let's look at verse 35. God then appears to Jacob, and strikingly, I mean, almost astonishingly, God doesn't comment on this. I mean, you and I would be wondering, God, do you have an opinion on this matter? And God basically says, you know what, you ought to move to Bethel. That's a better spot. So go to Bethel and move there and make an altar to me. And so God tells his people, his covenant people, it's time to move on. And Jacob then commands his people in his family group, all of the servants and family members, would have been a relatively large group. And he told them, God is moving us. We need to cast off all of our false gods and all of our false idols. And we discovered that they had idols among them. Some of the idols might have been the ones that his wife had stolen from her father Laban. Likely others were ones that they had collected when they destroyed Shechem. And he said, listen, I don't care how much they're worth. We need to throw them in a hole in the ground. So they dug a hole under an oak tree and buried those things and said, we are going where God calls us to go, and we're not going there in the strength of false gods. We're going there in the strength of God himself. And so they put away their false gods, and they began to make their move. Look at verse 5, and this is important because it connects back to the previous story where Jacob was so concerned about his safety and well-being. Look at verse 5. And as they journeyed, a terror from God fell upon the cities that were around them, so they did not pursue the sons of Jacob. What was Jacob so worried about? He was worried if he stuck a stick in the bee's nest, he'd get stung. But he had forgotten he was the son of the covenant. He doesn't have to worry about the Canaanites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Hittites and all the other ites. Because God is his God and he is a son of the covenant, and he can count on God honoring his covenant promises. And we see here his perspective should have been this way in the previous chapter. As he journeyed, the terror of God fell upon them, and they were able to make their way all the way to Luz, and which is now called Bethel, and they were able to get settled. And they built an altar to God, and God had made himself known to them. And so now it's almost like chapter 34. It seems like an aside, like, okay, we're getting off course, and then chapter 35 occurs, and Jacob is coming back, and he's going to serve and worship God alone and trust in his covenant promises. God protects him, and God leads him on. And then look at verse 8 with me. Verse 8 is the beginning of a major transition in the book of Genesis. Deborah, Rebecca's nurse, died. She was buried under an oak below Bethel. You know that one oak in Bethel? Yeah, that's the one. So he called that place Allon Bakuth. So here, all of a sudden, Deborah shows up. Do you remember Deborah? Of course, if you've read the book of Genesis or if it's been a little while, Deborah was one of Rebecca's maidservants. Rebecca is Jacob's mother, Isaac's wife. So it appears that Deborah at some point had joined Jacob's group, probably to tell him it's time to come home, or maybe to tell him that Isaac is getting near death. So what's happening here in the book of Genesis is it's beginning to make a shift. The old generation is passing away, and the next generation is now going to be the focus of God's covenant work among his people. Specifically, we're going to be moving from Isaac and Rebecca, moving from Jacob and Rachel and Leah to the sons of Jacob, and primarily for the rest of the book of Genesis, Joseph. And so we begin the wrapping up of that family story of Rebecca and Isaac here in verse 8. Deborah passes away, and God appears to Jacob. And God reaffirms to Jacob his covenant promises. And I want to read this covenant promise because this is repeated throughout the book of Genesis, and it's important for us to understand. Here's what it says. Your name is Jacob. No longer shall your name be Jacob, but Israel should be your name. Now, God had already told him this information back in Genesis chapter 32, but he's reminding him his identity is no longer based on who he used to be. His identity is based on the promises God has made to him, the blessings God has bestowed upon him, especially since he doesn't deserve those promises. And God said this, verse 11, I am God Almighty. Be fruitful and multiply. A nation and a company of nations shall come from you. Kings shall come from your body. And the land that I gave to Abraham, Isaac, I will give it to you. I will give the land to you and your offspring after you. And then God went up from him there, and Jacob built a pillar and a site of worship where he could recognize that God had spoken to him. And so now God has appeared to him. And one of the things we always want to ask ourselves when we see a covenant promises of God appearing to somebody, as we do in this case, God shows up to Jacob and says, here's a promise I make to you. We should ask ourselves this. Does Jacob deserve those covenant promises? Maybe just narrow it down to a couple of chapters. Read about Jacob in chapter 34. The Jacob of chapter 34, does he deserve the covenant-keeping God making promises to him in this moment? What's the answer? Of course he doesn't. Nobody deserves the covenant-keeping promises of God. That's what's so amazing about reading the book of Genesis. When you and I are reading this, we're not looking for heroes who deserve God's work. we're discovering people who don't deserve God's covenant promises who receive them nonetheless. Why is that great? Because we don't deserve God's covenant promises. God is bestowing on us a covenant in the blood of Christ we do not deserve. Not just over the course of our whole life. We don't deserve it based on yesterday. Just think about yesterday. Just whatever that day held for you yesterday. Based on yesterday, do you deserve the covenant promises of God? Of course not. Neither do I. But the fact is, this is the kind of God that we serve. He is the kind of God that makes really good promises to people who don't deserve them. So God reaffirms his covenant to Jacob because God's concern is, I'm going to work through these people to bring the seed who will fulfill all of my promises and bring that covenant to bear on all people. And so that covenant is reaffirmed. All right, now let's begin the unwinding of the story of Isaac and Jacob. And just real quick, I'm going to look here because it looks like I might have a couple of questions. One question that is asked here, wouldn't Jacob's way be better? I'm assuming here we're talking about sort of being passive and going easy, because then Dinah would have had a chance at life with a man who appears to have plans to care for her, and now she is nothing but her family's burden. Man, fantastic question. And maybe in any normal situation, saying, you know what, she has somebody to care for her, because now having received this shame and humiliation, there's a chance she may never be able to marry. What is going to happen to Dinah? Wouldn't it be better just to, like, let's just be cool with it. She's got somebody to take care of her. He's kind of a bit of a clod, but at least he's going to take care of her and give her three meals a day and a roof over her head. And I think in many ways, that would be fair in this cultural context. However, this is the covenant people of God. And the story of Genesis is the seed to come from the covenant people of God. So not only do we have concerns about Dinah's well-being, but the primary concern of the book of Genesis is fidelity to the covenant promises of God. And them mixing with another people is not having fidelity to God's people set apart to bring the seed. And so I think when we really look at the covenant promises of God over the book of Genesis, we say, no, not the only way that it would work is if Shechem and Hamor would abandon their identity and instead determined to be people of Israel. But that's not what they were doing. They were looking to make a business deal. So that's a fantastic question. Thank you for that question. Good stuff. Okay, let's look at verse 16 of Genesis chapter 35, and we'll probably go through this relatively quickly because I'm hoping to be done by about quarter to one. So they went on from there, and Rachel went into labor. Rachel, of course, is Jacob's wife, and it's his favored wife. And when her labor was at its hardest, the midwife told her, don't worry, you're going to have another son. And she was dying in birth, and she named him Ben-Oni, but his father later renamed him Benjamin, and Rachel. So Rachel died. Rachel dies giving birth to Benjamin. And she was buried on the way as they were making their way toward and up to Bethel. And so the burial site is near and around Bethlehem. And he set up a tent, or I should say he set up a pillar there and set up a tomb for her. And of course, this is beginning a major shift in the story of the book of Genesis. Now we're moving. Benjamin is born. And who are Jacob's two favorite sons? It's his sons born to Rachel, Benjamin, but of course, his favorite, Joseph. And as we move out of chapter 36 into chapter 37, the rest of the book of Genesis, from 37 on, is the story of God's work in his people through primarily Joseph himself. And so this is beginning that shift. Benjamin is born as his mother, Rachel, dies, and they bury her and they move along. And then finally, of course, Isaac is nearing his death. So I'm going to read, because I want to summarize all of the people of Jacob, beginning in verse 23. Now the sons of Jacob were 12. The sons of Leah, Reuben, Jacob's firstborn, Simeon and Levi, city killers, Judah, Issachar, Zebulun, the sons of Rachel, who has just died, Joseph and Benjamin, the sons of Bilhah, Rachel's servants, Dan and Naphtali, the sons of Zilpah, Leah's servant, Gad and Asher. These were the sons of Jacob who were born to him in Paddan Aram. So these are the sons of the covenant going forward. These are the sons who are going to be the primary theme of the book of Genesis after chapter 36. So Jacob came to his father Isaac. Isaac is very old. The Bible tells us in verse 28, he's 180 years old. Isaac died, and verse 29 ends this major section of the book of Genesis. Isaac died, old and full of days. His sons Esau and Jacob buried him. Like this brief glimpse and window of time where there's family peace. Just for a moment, there is peace between Jacob and Esau and all the sons, and most of the book of Genesis, that's going to be completely absent. And now from here on out, the story of Genesis is going to be the story of Joseph saving his family down in Egypt. All right, that's chapter 35. Chapter 36 is Esau's descendants. You can read that at your leisure. It's compelling and exciting reading, a list of names that are nearly impossible to pronounce, but you can read it at your leisure. The reason chapter 36 is there, again, because we're wrapping up in Genesis this major section of the story and moving on to Joseph for the rest of the story of Genesis, and this is sort of a wrap-up chapter. Esau's descendants, he's the father of the Edomites, and that is sort of wrapping up because 37 begins the story of Joseph. All right, let me just check to see if there's one other question here. All right, some application points, some implications we might have, some things I might just point out. This is a really interesting story, but I like to add in here, although we've done a little bit of it already, ways in which maybe you can own this yourself. First thing, shame is a major theme in the Bible, especially this passage, chapter 34. Shame is a major theme. When we experience shame, what we want justice. When we are shamed, we want justice. When we are sinned against and we experience shame because of what somebody has done to us, we want justice. When we do something wrong and we feel shame, we want grace. And both justice and grace are found through faith in God Himself, primarily shown to us at the cross. So we receive grace because we know the blood of Christ was shed for us that we might receive forgiveness. But many of us have also been sinned against in very significant ways. And we wonder, well, how will there ever be justice? Well, there's two ways there's going to be justice. Number one, that individual will one day have to stand before God and give account for their deeds. And if they are not in Christ, they will experience the justice of God. However, if that person who has wronged you is in Christ, we look at the cross, and this may be uncomfortable to think about, but it's critically important. And we say justice was done because all wrongs ever done have found their justice complete at the cross. God doesn't gloss over wrongs that are done to us. God accounts for every single wrong that has been done to us. Justice is either going to be borne by the individual who has done it, or justice is borne by Christ on the cross. But we find both justice and grace through the cross by faith. Secondly, think of circumcision in chapter 34. How did the sons of Israel use circumcision in chapter 34 against Shechem and Hamor and the city? They used it as a weapon. As a weapon. Religion as a club. Historically, people have used faith and religion as a means to control people. The gospel is intended to free people. It's a matter of faith. Do we have the ability to trust that God can work in the hearts of the people around us? Or are we going to be like many Christians throughout history? We use religion as a way to control the people around us. Religion should not be a weapon. In fact, it's designed to be freeing. And one of the ways we can look at our own heart when we look at how we apply the truth of God's love to our own heart and the people around us, are we trying to control others, or are we trying to free them in the grace of Christ? And we should not ever use religion or our faith as a club to control others. Okay, two more thoughts, and then we will close. Community shame. This is such a foreign concept to us. In our culture, and for most of us, we think our shame and our sin is individual. The individual has sin, so the individual has shame. But the Bible has this idea of individual shame and sin is completely a foreign concept in the Bible. All sin in the Bible is community sin. All shame in the Bible is community shame. We even see this in the New Testament. The Philippian jailer asked Paul, "How do I get saved?" And the answer was this: "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved." What comes right after that? Do you remember the verse? "You and your whole household." Even the Philippian jailer, who was not yet saved, understood the concept that people operate in faith in community. In the Corinthian church, Paul was talking about particular sins that were occurring in the body of Christ, and he was not saying that guy has a sin issue. He was telling the body of believers, you guys have a sin issue. And we need to do a better job of having the Bible educate our culture and say, you know what? Sin is not my problem. Sin is something we need to work on together. We need to bear one another's burdens, calling each other to holiness. Dealing with sin in our lives is a team effort. Finally, last thing, all of the Old Testament anticipates Jesus. And especially, I hope you were able to see in chapter 34 here, an anticipation. Jesus is not passive on the justice we need. He engages fully with the fact that we need justice, and he engages fully with the fact that we need his grace. Jesus is not passive like Jacob, and he is not out of control looking for revenge like Jacob's sons. Instead, he is the exact Savior we need, the Son of the Covenant who fulfills everything we see in the Old Testament, and chapter 34 in particular anticipates that. All right, well, we've wrapped it up. We've made it in, looks like, 49 minutes all the way through three chapters of Genesis. I really hope this was beneficial for you. If you want to hear it again because you missed something, I know I did. Again, we're going to replay this again at 7 o'clock tonight, and we'll look forward to being with you tomorrow, 12 p.m. We'll be having another Bible teaching time right here in the Worship Center, live streaming, 12 p.m., and you aren't going to want to miss it. Let me close our time in prayer, and then we're going to, do we dismiss? I don't know. I guess we just log off, but we're going to close in prayer. God, we thank you for this time. God, we ask right now in this moment, many of us do have a sense of shame and guilt in our life. We ask, God, that we might, in faith, be able to come to you and allow you to take that shame and sin. Even if it's recent and fresh in our mind, Lord, would you give us the faith to look at the cross and realize our shame and guilt has been dealt with? God, also in our heart, there's a deep need for justice, and many of us have experienced wrongs against us, which we don't know if we're ever going to be able to get over. Would you allow us, God, to release that into your hands? Because you are the only one who can truly handle our wrongs exactly how they should be dealt with. God, we pray that you would bring us back together soon. We really are thankful that you've given us the opportunity to interact online and over live stream. But God, we want to be back together. So would you quickly bring this isolation and the spread of the coronavirus to an end, that we could gather again as a body of believers and worship you as one. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless, and we'll see you next time. Has lost its grip.
my mind.